Hey, what's up guys? Welcome back and I hope you had a fantastic new year. I wanted to kickstart 2020 with a brand new video series that I put together showing a full CG visual effects shot from start to finish. We're going to be covering a lot of information, everything from how to set up your Maya scene file, doing file referencing, materials, V-Ray lighting, V-Ray rendering, as well as render passes, render layers, and the overall batch render process. Next, we're going to jump over to After Effects and then composite with multi-channel EXR files and then render out a final preview file. So there's going to be a lot of information in these videos. I was trying to speed it up and not linger too long on certain subjects, but I did try to explain what we're doing, not just which buttons to press. So I'm going to break this video up into several components. I will also have a full-length video available when all the videos are posted, so if you'd rather have the whole thing in one go, you might want to stick around for that video. I'll also have links in the description so you can jump ahead to specific points. If that sounds interesting, let's get started. Okay, so in this first video, we're going to go over how to set up your Maya project folder properly, how to do file referencing, as well as some camera stuff with some animation. We'll also be using a little expression to add some turbulence to a plane. Let's get started. So for this tutorial, we're using a model of a T38, and I downloaded the model from TurboSquid, which is available here, done by EGP Jet3D. Now the model is free, but I made several modifications to the plane, including adding extra detail, modified textures, and some extra detail in the geometry, as well as the two pilots in the cockpit. So if you'd like to use the one on TurboSquid, go ahead and download it from the site. Otherwise, you can check the link in the description and download my modified version. Just be aware that I do not own the rights to this model, so I would appreciate it if you did not distribute it without crediting the original author. The very first thing that we need to do is make sure we have our folders and projects set properly. So I have a project folder set up, and inside the project folder I have an assets folder. This is for objects we'll be referencing, such as the plane. We have a scenes folder. This is for the Maya scene files, and a source images folder. At this point, these are the only folders that we need. I don't recommend doing the automated approach, which will generate a lot of folders that we will never need. This keeps our folder hierarchy pretty clean, and we can create more as needed. So we need to set our project here, copy this path, up to file, set project, paste in the path, and then click select folder. Now we need to create a workspace, so just create a default workspace, and then we're good to go. What we need to do now is get our object inside of Maya, and there are two ways to do that. There's importing, which will take that object and save it inside the Maya scene file, and there's also referencing. So referencing has two main advantages, and the first advantage is it allows other people to work on that same model while, let's say, animators start animating it. So in a typical production environment, once you have started on the model, animators will need to start animating with it. So you will want to have people who can work on the files at the same time, so modelers can continue to make changes and animators can at least start working with something. It also allows updating a model with a newer version, very, very simple, or even swapping out to a completely different model entirely. This is very, very convenient. The second advantage is that it keeps your Maya scene files smaller. For example, if you have a very, very large model or a collection of models, and those models are being saved inside each Maya scene file, your scene files could easily be in the hundreds of megabytes or even gigabytes, and if you're saving multiple versions of these files, you're going to use a lot more space. With referencing, you're only going to be looking at one file, and all the scenes that use that reference will point to one object and not have duplicates of that object in each scene. So we're going to be using that method. Let's go up to File, Create Reference, and we're looking in the Assets folder for T38 Talon FBX, double click. So references are indicated in the outliner with a little blue diamond in the icon. So this means that we can change things like the animations, we can change textures and materials, but we can't change the geometry itself. So changes to the geometry will have to be done on that FBX file directly. So what we're going to do now is we're going to add some animation to this plane. And the way we're going to do this is with some simple expressions. We're going to go up to Create, Locator, and the locator is going to act as an additional way of being able to move this plane. So when you're moving this locator, you could think of trying to place it where the center of balance is. For a much larger plane, it makes it seem a little bit more realistic if the locator is lower, but for something lightweight like this, you could do something just above the wing. So next, what we're going to do, we're going to take this T38 model, metal mouse click and drag it over the locator, and now this locator can be animated with an expression, but we can still animate the plane directly, such as rotation here. Okay, so for this locator, we're just going to call this turbulence. And then we're going to add an expression to the rotate. So we're going to right click on rotate and create new expression. We have the object and attribute name. We can copy this down here. I'm going to paste this in, and we're going to specifically say rotate X. So we're going to use a noise expression, and we're passing in the time parameter, which will give us a unique number every frame. And we're just going to multiply this by, let's say, a quarter. Then we're going to repeat this step for Y and Z. So we'll just copy this and just change the letters. Right here, instead of doing 0.25, I'll do something like 5 instead. Then we click Create. We could just move this off to the side. Now, when you use an expression on a channel, you'll get a little purple box, which indicates it's being driven by an expression. And I'm going to extend this timeline to 200 frames. So what we've got right now, the plane is kind of wobbling slightly. So to edit changes, if you don't have your window open anymore, you can just right click and say Edit Expression. And then when you open up that box again, you just click Edit to save those changes. What we've done, we've added some just slight amounts of turbulence, and doing this type of animation would take a long time to do by hand, and we've done it just in a few seconds. And the reason we have a locator is so we can take this plane and then still be able to animate our own custom animations of it banking or going up and down or whatever we want. Okay, so next we need to create a camera. I'm going up to Create Camera, just a regular camera. Now I'm going to keep my perspective view, click Space. And we're going to go over to a new view, right click over the camera, and then say camera one. And we're going to position this camera. One of the things that we need to do when setting up a camera is determine the correct focal length. Focal length is absolutely vital when doing visual effects, because if you use a camera focal length that is incorrect, it's going to give away the fact that this is a CG shot. For example, this is by default a 35mm lens. Go into your attribute editor, camera shape, and view it here. A 35mm lens is considered wide angle. So to frame this in the shot properly, we'll want to take our resolution gate, and this indicates what is going to be rendered. You can tell this is wide angle by the foreshortening, so the front end of the plane looks a lot larger than the back end of the plane, but in visual effects, you always try to mimic what a camera would see. And if this was for a film or a movie, whatever, it would require another plane to be flying very close to this one so the cameraman can take this shot. But using a focal length of 35 would require the videographer to get very, very close to that plane, and that would be well outside what is considered a safe distance. So if for doing aerial photography, you would want to have your focal length set to something more like 80. 80 is going to flatten the image out, it's going to reduce the foreshortening, and this is going to look more realistic. So if you look at any type of examples of aerial aviation photography or videography, you will more commonly see much higher focal lengths. So I would say 80 is a pretty good low value. You could go all the way up to 120, and that would be considered pretty normal as well. I'm going to leave mine at 80. So right here, we're going to start at frame 0, and I'm going to position the camera somewhere here. I'm going to click S to set a keyframe for all the channels. And then we're going to go all the way to the very end of where we want the animation to stop. So I'm going to say that's going to be probably around 185. I'm going to pop over to a perspective view here so I can cant the angle very slightly, something more like this. And when you're framing the shot, you just want to make sure you have enough space at the edge. So if you wanted to add camera shake or something, which would require you to cut in a little bit off your shot, you still have room at the sides. Something like that will be fine. We just need one other keyframe to keep the plane in the shot. So let's go to frame 120, and we'll just lower that to there. I'm going to pull out a little bit here at the beginning. Now I also have the auto keyer on, so this is why I don't have to keep hitting S. So something like this would be pretty good. So next we're going to go into the graph editor, so Windows, Animation, Graph Editor. And there's a few things that we need to do here. So let's switch over to the channel box. We do not need animations on all of these frames. So what we can do is go up to Edit, Delete by Type Static Channels, and that will remove anything that does not have a keyframe on it. And then right here, I'm going to make these tangents linear. I want the camera to already be moving at the very beginning of the shot, not be stationary. So it's not going to ramp up speed. It's already going to be going pretty fast. So we can come back and tweak these later. For now, this is fine. And I'm actually going to make one more change here. I'm just going to raise this a little bit so it's not going to go quite so close to the edge. But something like that's pretty good.
All right, guys, hope you enjoyed part one of this tutorial series. If you learned something, drop a like. If you have any questions, drop a comment. Otherwise, I'll see you in the next video. Peace.